Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship. It's just a joy to welcome you and greet you this morning in the name of our Lord. Let's stand together. We're going to sing the great song, Hosanna.
Will you please join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, this beautiful day that you have made, Lord. And as we celebrate this Christ the King Sunday, when we call you Lord, may that not just be a title that we give you, that we ascribe to you, but may it actually be true that you are the Lord of our lives, that you are in control, that you are sovereign, that we place everything before you. As we come into your house this day, as we worship and we celebrate and just share life with one another, that we would just lay our lives before you now and take up the cross. And God, as we leave this week, that we would live as servants of you to be your church that you have called us to be. And Father, we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And you may be seated. Well, it's a pleasure to welcome everyone to the Lord's house today, and I greet not only those who are members, but any guests that we have. We always ask everyone to fill out the connection slip, place it in the basket as you come forward to share offering. If you're a first-time guest, please exchange that slip at the Welcome Center. We'd love for you to find out more about the Lord's ministry here at Trinity and hope you come back to be with us. Just a few quick announcements. This coming weekend is the Christmas Bazaar. We have over 50 vendors that are going to be here, plenty of food, breakfast with Santa. There are two sittings for breakfast with Santa in the morning. You can register for that online, so you'll see the insert for that event. It's going to be a great event here on Saturday, so please come and be with us. Also, Fellowship has put on one of the inserts all the things where they're looking for some help and support from the congregation from now through Christmas. The first one is this Wednesday. We have our Thanksgiving Eve worship at 7 o'clock, and then we usually go to Fellowship Hall and have a pie social. Well, I know a lot of people just bring the pies at the last minute, but they like to know how many, if they have to buy any. And right now, I think we only had about 10 pies marked off of people bringing them. We usually have about 40. So especially on that sheet, if you think you can bring a pie, mark that off and put it in. Let us know you're bringing one for a great worship on Thursday night. And also, we tried to collect this year all the food for Thanksgiving and Christmas for our food baskets that go out to families in need. We've collected about 95% of that, so we're just going to wait another week, and we may not even have to ask for any food, additional food for Christmas, because all of it has come in, so that's wonderful. And that allows the congregation now to do what we wanted, and that's to really focus on the angel tree gifts, the gifts for children that will go home with those food baskets at Christmas time. All right, we had the pleasure this month, in this month's new member class, having 8 adults who are going to join the Fellowship of Trinity. And so I'm going to take a moment right now and call those new members up by name and remind everyone to participate in the new member service. It'll be upon our worship screen. And so we'd like to begin by calling Nicholas Bittorf and Jessica Florio to come forward. I'm calling them together out of alphabetical order because they're engaged. I thought they'd want to stand next to each other. So come on over here next to the rail. And then we have Katie and Ryan Katula. Katie and Ryan, where are they? I think they were trying to come back. They had their child baptized this morning at the early service, so we'll see if they're going to be here. Jamie Molenkamp. Where's Jamie? Oh, there she is. And we're going to have Madeline Bragg and Dawn Sandoval to come forward. And then Jordana Sukodolski, is that correct? Close? All right, good. Jordana, though, is pretty, so hopefully I got that right. Okay, Ben.
All right. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for these brothers and sisters whom you have made your own by water and the word in baptism. You've called them to yourself, enlightened them with gifts of your spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Please stand for the creed.
Let us confess our faith together. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Congregation may be seated. And Dawn, I'm going to invite you to come forward and just stand directly behind the baptismal font. You can face back to the congregation. And it's Dawn Marie. Okay. Dawn Marie Sandoval, I baptize you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Behold the child of the Lord. Okay. And now I share with each of you, as members of our new member class, you have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant that God has made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God, and to share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If this be your confession today, please respond individually by saying, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
Okay. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, we pray that you would stir up within Nicholas the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm his faith and guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Jessica the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm her faith and guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Let me see, here we go to Dawn. Okay. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Dawn the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm her faith and guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Madeline the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith and guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Jordana the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm her faith and guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Jamie the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm her faith and guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. I'm going to ask you to turn and face the congregation, if you would, and invite the congregation to share in the spoken welcome with me as we welcome these brothers and sisters in Christ. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. So I'm guessing that wasn't on the screen. All right. But in their hearts, they were welcoming you.
Okay. Yeah.
How about if we do that? Well, since we've gone to new member classes once a month, our classes are a little bit smaller, sometimes a dozen, 15, sometimes 8 to 10, but it's really great to get to know our new members a little bit better. And please, they have to keep their name tags on the whole morning, so you'll be able to see them, especially after church, and to welcome them and greet them as well. So my friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I'm going to invite you right now to please stand and to come out of your pew and to share that peace now one with another. Okay, I'm going to invite you to work your way back to your pew and to stay standing. And even though this is the final Sunday of the church year, you can believe it, this next weekend we have the first weekend of Advent, 4 weeks then until Christmas. And it's Christ the King Sunday, but we also have the scriptures a little bit different because we're finishing our three-week series on rethinking generosity. So Barry's going to share the lesson with us now.
Today's lesson comes from Luke chapter 9, starting at the 10th verse. When the apostles returned, they reported to Jesus what they had done. Then he took them with him, and they withdrew by themselves to a town called Bethsaida. But the crowd learned about it, and they followed him. He welcomed them and spoke to them about the kingdom of God and healed those who needed healing. Late in the afternoon, the 12 came to him and said, "Send the crowd away so they can go to the surrounding villages and countrysides and find food and lodging, because we are in a remote place here." He replied, "Give them something to eat." They answered, "We only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, unless we go and buy food for all this crowd." About 5,000 men were there, but he said to his disciples, "Have them sit down in groups of about 50 each." The disciples did so, and everyone sat down. Taking 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish and looking up to the heaven, he gave thanks and broke them. Then he gave them to the disciples to distribute to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 baskets full of broken pieces that were all left over. It's the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And you may be seated. A child was born about 5.5 weeks premature. And in those days, it wasn't as easily handled as it is today. The little one's lungs were not fully formed, and it really wasn't clear whether this child would make it. It was touch and go for a good while. Because of that, the two pastors at the parents' church then came to the hospital. And they baptized the child in the hospital, marking him with the cross of Christ and claiming him as a child of God. The ministers then stayed there in the hospital with the family, and they waited, and they prayed, and they waited and they prayed. Interesting enough, right from the very beginning, God, through his church, was there for this boy. God, through his church, was starting to make a difference in his life. The young child made it through. Although he began only 3 pounds and 6 ounces, he grew. He got stronger. And as a tiny tot, his parents brought him to the church where they worshiped. He grew up going to Sunday school and learning the wonderful stories about Jesus. He enjoyed singing in the children's choirs and placing a nickel in the offering envelope each week, sealing it, and then placing it in the Sunday school offering plate. The seeds were already starting to be planted. He was told that God loved him. He was told that the cross of Jesus was really important. He was told that loving other people was the way we were to act towards them. And he began to see that these group of people, the family of God, was a pretty okay place to be. All through his early years, you see, God, through his church, was starting to make a difference in his life. Now look, when he became a teenager, he was like any other normal teenager. He wasn't an angel all the time. He got into his share of trouble. He strained his parents' patience at times and made choices that they had clearly not taught him to make. At this time in his life, he started questioning the teachings of the church, started questioning some of the things that his parents had taught him. And he really started to be interested in girls. That added a whole new dimension to his life and a lot of stress too. His teenage years had many ups and downs, times of disappointments and success, moments of self-doubt and reestablished confidence, and days when he wasn't sure really exactly who he was, and other days when that seemed to become just a little bit clearer. He learned that his choices had consequences, that friends weren't always friends, and that his heart was something that could get hurt. I mean, really hurt. And even though it was taught in his day that young men didn't do this, sometimes he just couldn't help himself because there were times when he cried because of the stress and the rejection and the fears. He wept. But through all of this, you know, the place where he always seemed to find just enough of support and help was actually the youth ministry at his church and the people who were there. He really liked the youth leader, liked most of the kids that were there at youth group, enjoyed coming Saturday nights to Teen Center and enjoyed the youth retreats, and also coming on Sunday morning to the youth discussion class because they could ask things and discuss things that, boy, at home they would never discuss. Through all the uncertainty of his teenage years, the church and the faith and the encouragement of others helped to provide just enough stability and steadiness to his life. You see, God, through his church, was making a difference in his life, maybe more of a difference than he really knew. As a young adult, as many do, he began to fade away a little bit from God when he went to college. Didn't worship as much as he should. Didn't really open up the Bible as often as he could have. Now, he was fully involved in the college life, studying, playing a sport, joined and was very active in a fraternity. And even though he was stepping away from God, slowly but surely, God had a way of making him know, boy, that God wasn't stepping away from him. Once a month, he would receive a card in the mail at college from an elderly woman at church who sent a card to him once a month and filled up the blank space on the left of the card and all the blank space on the back with a personal note, letting him know what was going on that month at church. But because she knew him personally growing up in the church, she shared personal words of encouragement. And she always ended the note on the card, "Stay close to the Lord." He thought it uncanny how her personal words were always kind of rightly and exactly what he needed to hear. Sometimes it made him miss home. And actually, he started looking forward to receiving that card every month. And when he came home during Christmas and summer break, people at the church, seemed interested in him. They asked him how he was doing, how his studies were going, if he were behaving himself. Some people even said they were praying for him. Maybe they knew what he was doing in his fraternity. I don't know. And other people said that they were, my gosh, proud of him. Again, God through his church was making a difference in his life. Near the end of his senior year in college, his grandfather passed away. He loved him very much. He was very close to him. When he came back for the viewings and the funerals, with all the conflict and the heartache he was feeling, he was really surprised again at how the pastors, how the people who spoke to him, how God's comfort and strength came to him. And during that time, many of the things that he had known and that he had believed in God, about God's love and forgiveness and eternal life, those things came back to the forefront and embedded themselves in his heart. And there they would remain. All because during a difficult time, God, through his church, was making a difference in his life. This premature infant, this child, this youth, this young adult, you see, if you haven't guessed, was me. As I grew up here in this church, this being my home church. And what I would like to say to you this morning is that God, through his church, has never stopped making a difference in my life. After college, when I went to seminary, the church had a fund here that then they used to help me pay for all my books during seminary, and that was a wonderful gift. When I came here as a young pastor, Trinity provided love and support. And I am sure as a young pastor, you were very, very patient with me. I knew I had to earn your respect, but the amount of acceptance that was here for a boy that you saw grow up was amazing. God, through his church, has been there for the celebrations of my family's life. It started off pretty tough. Jennifer and I, and I'd shared this in a sermon, people knew. We had tried to get pregnant for 7 years. Pastor John told us, well, just keep on practicing. And we were, all right, we were. The doctors told us, you and Jen should be getting pregnant. There's no problem here. And there were so many people here who prayed for us and were very supportive. And then you celebrated with us the birth of our two boys as they were born and their baptisms. And you have helped us in this church to raise them in the ways of the Lord. And God, through his church, this church has been there for us during difficult times. In 2003, when I had the illness of cancer and the treatments that came along with it, in 2005, when I had a stroke and the months of recovery that it took, and you have consistently been very understanding and prayerful and helpful to us with our second son who is autistic with special needs. And I want to say to you, I am who I am most of all today because of how God has worked through his church and made a difference in my life. And you know, I know that I'm not the only one that has such a story. I know that I'm not the only one who, through the body of Christ, God has reached out to and helped and loved. And I know that there are those whose life stories are much different than mine. Many people who have life stories that are much more challenging than mine. In my 27 years of being a pastor here, I have heard the stories of other people. There are people in this church who have experienced abuse as a child and who were abused as a teenager, and the church became an advocate, a voice, and a protector for them. There are people who have struggled with addiction to alcohol and to drugs, and as they step towards recovery, and as every day
They battled to stay away from a drink or from drugs. The church has been a companion and a strength for them. There are people through the years here who have needed help and needed money to pay for their mortgage, to pay for their electric bill, or needed help to put food on their table, and the church has helped and supported them. There are those in this church who have lost someone to death. They have lost a parent they held dearly. They have lost a spouse of many years, and the hardest one that is still so tough, friends. There are people here who have lost a child. But for them, the church has been with them and prayed with them and cried with them and helped them to slowly but surely walk through that process of many months and sometimes a number of years of working through grieving. And there are those who have come into this church who have been weighed down because of the guilt in their life, because of choices that they have made. They carry the guilt of choices they have made in relationships of their life, or decisions that they have made even at their workplace, or things that they have chosen to do even when other people, no one saw them doing it. And their lives were burdened down, and their lives were still being defined by their past. But the church and its message of forgiveness, the church and its message of beginning anew with God, creating us and making us a new creation and starting over with God, help them move forward and help them move into a new way of life. There is no doubt in this place and other people's lives, God, through His church, has made a difference in their lives. But one of the things that really excites me is I see how God today, and it looks like in the future, how He will continue to make a difference here in people's lives. If you were to go back and just take a glimpse at the other end of the building right now and children who are in Sunday school, you will see others teaching them the stories of the Bible at their level so that they can understand, so that they can just know how much God loves them. If you would ever take a peek at a youth event that is held here during the week, or maybe if you had the courage to go with 30 junior high youth and 8 adults from our church who are down at Ocean City this weekend at the Alive Conference with over just hundreds of other junior high youth, you would see when the youth are gathering together that they are told it's okay to be who you are. And we accept you as you are. And for young people to know how important it is and joyful it can be to praise God, and how the most important relationship they will ever have in their life is their relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, I see with children and with youth, God is making a difference. And if you were just to get a glimpse of many of the mission outreaches we have, you know, the 50 baskets that went out yesterday to families, all the people that donated food, all the people that packed those baskets, all the people who got in their cars yesterday and took those gifts of food out to families. Or the food building, if you were ever to walk down there and see that food building open 3 days a week, this past year, because we have to keep record of the numbers, this past year so far, over 2,093 households have been provided food through that food building. Over 6,422 men, women, and children. Do you think God might be making a difference there? And if you were to tag along with a staff member, maybe a lay leader who does visitation here, maybe you would have followed them into a hospital this week or into someone's home or been in their office when someone came here and been with that staff person as they talked with and prayed with someone who has an upcoming surgery, someone who's recovering from surgery, someone in the middle of going through the process of cancer and treatments, being with someone who death is drawing near, talking with a person who needs help and counsel and guidance because of maybe their life circumstances right now, and being with people who are celebrating what? They want a baby baptized, or they want to get married in the church. And even this weekend, if we were to pack together everything that's going on in all three worship services here this weekend, songs will be sung, communion will be celebrated, babies will be baptized, new members will be welcomed in, and maybe as a message of the gospel is preached, when people hear again how God has loved them through the cross and resurrection of Jesus Christ, just maybe there will be a person through whom that message will touch, and as it reaches to their heart, they will what? Come back to God. Maybe they will recommit themselves to God. Maybe for the first time, they will say, I will walk with God. Here in this place, God is making a difference in people's lives. And I asked myself this question this week, what makes that possible? I would say two things. First and foremost, it's God. God is the one who established the church. God is the one who, through his Holy Spirit, works through the church. And God is the one who gathers us together as the church to work through. What did we say last week? We said, if you and I could take one word that would describe God the best, that would describe who God is at his very core, what would that be? And I said to you, I believe it is that God is a giver, that no one can outgive God, that God has given, you know, is the greatest giver to the world that the world will ever know. And through the church, you see, God has chosen through the church to give the benefits of his son's death and resurrection to people. It is through the church that God wishes to give his love and his grace and his forgiveness, his salvation, his comfort, his support, his joy. And so how does God most effectively do that? I then would say to you, the most effective way that God can give is then through the body of Christ, through us as his church. And last week, I also said this. As followers of Christ, we know that we're called every day to do better and better at what? Imitating him. Of emulating him. He was loving, we're to be loving. He was gracious, we are to be gracious. God is a giver, we are to be givers. And so this is the final week of what? A three-week series where we have been asked, hey, let's rethink generosity in our life. The first week we said, really evaluate your heart. Do you have a giving heart when it comes to the relationships of your life? Who you are for other people as you live life with them? Last week, we kind of got focused down on, yeah, how are we with generosity? What? With our financial blessings. And I know people get a little nervous when the pastor talks about that. And what I said last week, look, it is not my job to tell you what to give, to twist your arm and make you give, to make you feel guilty and give. Each one of us prayerfully ought to give what? As we are able, sacrificially, each one of us are asked to be faithful, to be givers to God's church. And so I want to say this loud and clear. God's made a difference in my life in this church. God has made, I believe, a difference in many people's lives through this church. And it is because people have possessed giving hearts that God has worked through and has used, what? The time that they have given and their abilities in which they have shared. But also, God has made a difference in people's lives because we have been open to saying, look, the financial area of our life, we're to be faithful there like any other area of our life. Paul says, excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, and in giving. And because people have given graciously, what? This ministry, God has allowed it then to be possible for him to work through. People's lives are changed here because of who God is and also because of how God works in and through his people. That is how it has always been, and that is how it needs to still be. And so I close by saying to you, it matters greatly if you and I possess gracious and generous and servant hearts here towards other people. And it matters here because God can work powerfully in and through us that we are gracious, yes, with the financial gifts that we have in our life and how we use them to accomplish his will. It certainly has made a difference in my life. And as a boy who grew up here, who has become a pastor and has served with you,
I am just one example of how God has made a difference in a person's life because this ministry was made available, this ministry was made powerful, and this ministry was made strong because of how God has worked through the graciousness of his people. Amen. Please stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you first and foremost for the relationship that you established with us, for the graciousness that you give us through the cross and resurrection. And we just pray, Lord, today as so many of us will come forward and hand in our commitment cards, maybe we'll mail them in this coming week or bring them next week, that you will use the gifts of your people, the gifts of who we are in relationships, the gifts of who we are with our gifts, and continue to move us forward to accomplish what you desire for us in this place. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
With the whole people of God, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you that your unending love is boundless and it's continuous, God, that you are not just some distant, disapproving Father, but that you do love us, that you take the initiative, and that you work through each and every one of our lives. Father, we thank you for the privilege that it is to be your church, to be your body, to be your bride, God, to be about the work that you are doing in this world. And Father, we know that, God, you can do all things, but Lord, you desire that we would turn our hearts to you, that we would surrender our lives to you in every area, God, in our time, our talents, those things that you have gifted us with and our abilities, and also our financial gifts, God. So, Father, we pray that as we just seek you now, that our hearts would be receptive, that you would just accept our gifts, work in each and every one of our lives to present before you what you have given us appropriately, proportionately, and God, that you would take those and you would multiply them for kingdom impact, that, Lord, you would just do a great thing through Trinity that we know that you want to do, that you have done, and that you will continue to do. So, Father, we just pray that you would continue to work through your people as we submit to you. And Lord, we just pray that as part of that, God, we lift up those who are hurting, those who are in need, those in our congregation and related to it. And Father, we lift up those on our prayer chain and in our bulletins. But Lord, we also pray out loud before you. We lift up Mark and Josh Franker. We pray for Linda D'Alfonso. We pray for Louisa Davis and Mary White. We pray for William Keane and Ruth Rusing and George Yeager, for Norman and Sandra Bartlett, for Sarah Causey and the Causey family, Joseph Cliff and Debbie Jones, Lisa Shoebridge, Janae Quayles and her family, Norma Jean Duer, Carol Bowman, Joanne Palin, Bobby Wheeler. We pray for Dennis Beekler, and Lord, we ask that you would be with Ron, the family of Ron Missel upon his passing this past week. We pray that you would give them peace and comfort and the hope that comes with the promise of your resurrection, that we will be united, reunited with one another and united with you, Lord, forever. And God, we pray for all those now who we mention, either silently or out loud. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen. My friends, on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Take away the melodies, take away the songs I sing, take away all the lies and all the songs you let me write. Does the man I am today say the words you need to say? Let them see you in me. Let them hear you when I speak. Let them feel you when I sing. Let them see you. Let them see you in me. Who am I without your grace? Another smile, another face, another breath, a grain of sand, passing quickly through your hand. I give my life and offer it. Take it all, take everything. Let them see it. Stories of what they think you're like, but I hear a tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased.
pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To
stand. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and always grant you his peace. Amen.
Thank you.
Have a great week in the Lord. Don't forget Thanksgiving Eve, bring a pie, and also this Saturday, the Christmas Bazaar. Two great events this week. Go in peace and serve the Lord.